Right, Andrew, you're very welcome. Paul, good to see you. And Beacom, the Crews lost points last weekend.
They did, surprisingly so, but you got to give credit to Ballymena United. They have started the season like a house on fire. David Jeffries brought in a lot of new players, and it seems to me they've gelled very quickly. By all accounts, Ballymena were superb in the first half. Crusaders did their usual, came back firing, and it was a brilliant game of football. But I imagine Crusaders will be disappointed. Two home games, and they only have 4 points on the board. They've a massive match this weekend against Linfield, and we'll talk about that one later. That will be a crackerjack of a football match.
Absolutely, Paul. Great win against Ards, and the Glen struggled against Ards last season.
Yeah, I think out of the four games, I think Glentoran won the two games at Ards' ground and vice versa then. So, you know, all over the place in terms of the results. But no, it was a good win for us on Saturday, and I thought in the first half we thoroughly deserved it. I think we could have been 3, possibly 4-1 up at half-time would have been a fair reflection. And then the second half, to be fair to Ards, they came into the game a bit more, conditions played their part. But we held strong, and it was good to get the win and the clean sheet as well.
And Andrew, I missed a penalty, sorry to bring it up again. But two goals on Saturday, and you took your chances really well, and two assists as well.
Yeah, after last week, it was good to get back to normality, I suppose, and scoring goals. And Saturday was a tough game for us, but we came through in the end, and it was good to come out 40 minutes.
How do you get yourself over missing a penalty?
I think you just have to be mentally strong. I know myself that I can score goals, and yeah, it was a big game, but you have to forget about it and just move on.
So this management dream team that's ongoing at the Oval, firstly, what's the setup?
Well, obviously Ronnie McFall's still the manager, Pete. Gary Smith and myself have still got to get complete our AFA licence course, which we've done the first part of that this year, and then we've got to finish the second part next year. But Ronnie McFall is still very much the manager. Gary will be the assistant manager, and then myself and Kieran Harding are very hands-on with the coaching. And so far it's been good. It's been, you know, it's a learning year. Personally for me, it's going to be very much a learning year. It's my first role in senior football coaching management. Whereas, you know, people like Ronnie and Kieran have been involved in it a lifetime. Gary Smith's been at the Wilders for 5 years now and done a tremendous job there. So for me, it's a good learning year. You're learning parts of management. I'm also doing quite a bit of coaching as well. So far, it's been really enjoyable.
You had your time at Seaview, and we know how well that went. But your heart lies at the Oval. It always did do. So going back to coach now, what's it like for you?
Yeah, I'd much rather be playing. Pete, you know, playing's the easy part. You're seeing things from a totally different perspective. When you're a player, you prepare for the game, you turn up and play. That's the easy part. When you're coaching, it's all week long. You're thinking about the game, you're thinking about training sessions, you're constantly talking about players and preparation and looking at the opposition. So it's, as I say, it's a whole learning experience for me, but it's great to be back involved at Glentoran again. It's, you know, people would always say to me, you're always going to end up back there. It's probably came about sooner than I thought. But we're there now, and it's a massive challenge, make no bones about it.
I was at the Oval for the Cliftonville game. The boys looked totally dejected, losing all 3 points in the dying moments of the game. Because you're not on the pitch, you can't influence that yourself. How frustrating is that?
That's what I'm finding. You know, you hear managers saying they're kicking every ball. Certainly for the two games that I've been involved in the touchline so far, you're kicking every ball. You wish you were out there able to do something about it. But the Cliftonville game, you know, I thought we got 110% effort from all the boys, and that's all we could ask for. I thought we were really unlucky to lose the goal so deep into injury time. But the boys have got to learn from that, because really when the board goes up for 2 minutes of additional time, that's when game management comes into it, and players have got to, you know, shut up shop and do things professionally, and hopefully we can learn from that mistake.
How does it work in the dressing room, Leeper? You've got four big voices there, so who speaks? And, you know, to me it's a really interesting dynamic, because I'm so pleased to see yourself and Gary Smith back at the Oval, but Ronnie and Kieran still there. So explain to the viewers how it works in the dressing room.
Well, as I've said to Pete there, Stephen, Ronnie McFall's still the manager, very much still the manager. His decision is final. He's given the team talks. He's picking the team, but, you know, we all have our say. We all have our input, and Gary Smith, again, someone with great managerial experience at the Wilders, you know, Gary will say things in the dressing room as well. Myself and Kieran are more involved in the coaching. I would like to think that, you know, I would be involved in the preparation and the warm up with the players, so I have my individual words with the players when we're out in the pitch working, and Kieran would be the same. Kieran would do a lot of the technical stuff as well, but in terms of the main voice, it's still Ronnie McFaul and with Gary Smith assisting him. So it's all working well so far.
You are a Glentoran legend. How tough has it been the last few years watching what Glentoran have gone through?
Yeah, it's been tough. Obviously, I didn't leave the club the way I wanted to leave, and I went on to Crusaders and had, you know, four tremendous years there. But for me, being away from the club and seeing the decline, it hasn't been easy, because I'm a Glentoran fan through and through and watched the club since I was a boy. And, you know, I always want to see the club doing well. I think everyone in the Irish League, we all say it, we need a strong Glentoran. So it hasn't been easy to watch that. And I think it's sort of got this stage now, I think, is that changes have to be made, whether that be at board level. Changes have happened at managerial level now, and it's small steps to try and get the club back to where it needs to be, but it's not going to happen overnight.
So you're in there, you're doing your coaching, but we've heard about Ronnie, but what about Gary? You know, leaving Harney Wolf Welders to take that job, was that a difficult decision for him?
I'm sure it was, because he'd done a great job there. He'd been there 5 years, and they were probably punching above their weight in that division. I think they were in the top three last year, and he'd won a few trophies there. So I'm sure that was a difficult decision for Gary. But Gary's like myself. He's a born winner in football. He's ambitious, and he's a Glentoran man as well. And, you know, he's come in, and he's up for the challenge, as I am, and I'm sure he'll give it his all.
Right, what's the aim for this season in terms of where you hope to finish? What's the plan with the players? Are you putting more emphasis on the league or the cups, or what's the crack?
I think certainly the league form has got to become more consistent, Pete. It's been really inconsistent over the last few years, and people say about the top six. Yes, the top six is a target, but I think we've got to get that consistency in the league. Certainly our home form has got to improve. The form at the Oval simply hasn't been good enough the last few years. And I think we need to certainly look at the cup competitions and try and get a run in the County Antrim Shield, the League Cup, the Irish Cup.
Is it the pressure of the fans at the Oval? Is that where the issue is?
I think it is. The expectation's always going to be there at Glentoran. The fans have been used to success for so many years. But I think, you know, the fans have now realised that, you know, something has to change. They've got to give people time, and maybe they're not going to be where they used to be overnight. So they've got to give it time. They've got to be patient. The fans have got to get behind these players that we have in the squad now and you know, try and drive them on and get us further up the league.
Well, whenever you were playing on the pitch and you were getting whatever shouted at you from the sidelines, how did you blank that out, and how did you not let that affect you in terms of your performance?
I think when I got out on the pitch, you had a job to do, Pete, and you were mentally strong. And some players, you've seen players who have been brilliant at, you know, lesser clubs, so to speak, come to Glentoran with a big reputation and just haven't done it. And that's the pressure of playing for a big club. The same thing's happened here at Linfield. Whereas someone like myself, I wanted to play for Glentoran. I knew what I had to do. I knew the levels that I had to achieve to stay in the team, and I was mentally strong. So I didn't care what was shouted at me. I had my job to do, and I'd like to think I'd done it to the best of my ability.
To be fair, Pete, not too many people shouted negative things
at Leeper. Yes, yeah,
I suppose he was very good.
There was plenty, Stephen, plenty.
Ronnie's been there, he's done that. He's there for a reason. Do you think he's enjoying it?
Yeah, he wouldn't be there if he wasn't still enjoying it. I can see it in Ronnie that he still enjoys being around the players. He's a tremendous character. He's been about the Irish League for so many years, obviously at Glentoran and then at Portadown, and he's certainly still enjoying it. I mean, he brings myself and Gary every day. As I say, we all have our input, and Ronnie, he's a football man. He loves being involved, and it's, you know, full credit to him for stepping up, and because if it wasn't for him, you know, this managerial setup couldn't happen. So full credit to Ronnie.
The long term plan is for Gary and yourself to take over.
Yeah, that's a long term plan, and as I say, you know, this year is going to be a good year in terms of learning. You know, the coaching role for me, Gary coming in at a bigger club than what he's been working at before, and basically you've got to look and see what needs to change, Stephen, whether that be players, whether that be discipline, organisation, professionalism. There's a lot of things that we can improve on, and hopefully we can learn over this next year and put things into place for the future.
Right, Andrew, how's things at Glen Avon?
Things are going well. Obviously, our first game against Linfield was a bit of a disappointment. We had a pretty good summer in terms of our Europa League campaign. Fantastic result against Molde at home. Unfortunately, the away result just didn't go our way. We were maybe a goal away from maybe getting through, and they scored two goals in the last couple of minutes. But we took heart from those two games and moving into the new season. Linfield was obviously disappointing, but last week we knew we had to come back, and we hit back really well with a good win against Worm Point.
You get a taste of that European football. How important is it to cement your place in the league to get that next season?
European football is massive for any team in the Irish League. You know, I think it's imperative for us this year that we get European football again, and that revenue is really invaluable for each club.
So two goals on Saturday, obviously righting the wrongs of the missed penalty, the week before. How much confidence do you gain from that going forward?
Yeah, it's massive. Whenever you experience a disappointment like that, you have to follow it up with a real positive. And I knew I was thinking about it all week that, you know, I'm going to score. There's no other way. You can't think negatively. You have to think positive. And I'm just happy that it worked out that way for me on Saturday.
Yeah, no points on the board for Bourne Point. How much trouble do you reckon they're going to be in this season? How tough do you reckon they're going to find it?
It's going to be tough for every team. The Irish League's a tough league. Bourne Point, you know, they started the game well against us. We probably didn't start for the first 20, 25 minutes, and they pressed us pretty hard, and they got their goal. But again, our quality kind of shone through in the end, and yeah, it's going to be difficult probably for them, being down around the bottom for the past few years, but I've no doubt that they'll pick up points here and there.
Mark Sykes, class act. Are you surprised he's still at Glenappen?
Yeah. Sexy class. He's got everything. He's got pace. He's got skill. He can score goals. I don't know how he's still here. I think somebody probably will still take a chance on him at some point. I mean, he's only probably 21, 22. There's still plenty of time for him.
Pete, I have to say, he's too modest to tell you himself, Andy, but on Saturday, his performance was absolutely sensational. Showed real character and bottle after missing that penalty, and he brought Glenavon back into that game. It was the biggest compliment I could pay you, Andy, was it reminded me of Glenn Ferguson in a Glenavon shirt. That's how good he was. He scored two goals, he made two other goals, and he bossed that Warren Point defence all over the shop. It was fantastic. I'd love to know, Andy, what's it like playing in that Glenavon team? Because sometimes I think defence goes out the window. I really do. Like, you know, there were occasions on Saturday when Warren Point were breaking 3-on-1 and yous were ahead in the game, so it wasn't as if you were chasing the match. But you've got Joshua Daniels down one side, Andy Hall, you mentioned Sykes, who I think is a fantastic player, Niall Grace has come in. It's all out attack, really, isn't it?
Yeah, well, we do have good defenders there as well, in our back four, and Reece, Doyler, Kaelin and Singo. And you've obviously got Tuffy and Nets, who's outstanding. But in terms of going forward, we are a good unit. You've obviously got Andy and Josh there in the wings who always produce great deliveries into the box. And if I'm not in the box, I'm not doing my job. So my aim is to be in the box at all times. And, you know, it was a first start for Steve Donnelly up front as well, who has come in from amateur league down south. And I thought he was brilliant as well. And he deservedly got his goal for his work on Saturday. So it's really enjoyable playing in the Glenavon side because you have that much attacking flair.
Can Coleraine, what they did last season, inspire a provincial club like Glenavon to try and go for the title?
Absolutely. What Coleraine achieved last year was magnificent, and winning the Irish Cup here, I think, really highlighted that for them. I think it's definitely our goal that we want to progress, and I think Irish Cup again is something we needed to target as well. We let ourselves down badly last year, obviously going out to Loughall. So we will be looking to really progress.
On that note, you mentioned about provincial club going on to win the league. Can you see any team other than Crusaders winning this league campaign?
Yeah, well, Coleraine, they've got to be looking to go one better than last season. Linfield have a big point to prove this season as well, and Cliftonville. They look as if they have a squad that could challenge. So these teams will all take points off each other, Pete. But I still think Coleraine are going to be mount a serious challenge, and I think Linfield will be up thereabouts again.
It was really the three. It was yourselves, Coleraine, Crusaders for the most part of last season. After Christmas, you guys sort of fell away. But why do you think that was?
Our home form, pretty bluntly, to be honest. We didn't perform at home. Our away form was very good. We picked up a lot of good points. But again, that's our home form is something that we really need to pick up on this year, and that's definitely something that we've targeted. Obviously, it didn't start off too well last week, but there's a lot more games to come this year, and hopefully our home form will pick up, and we'll continue to pick up points away from home, and hopefully that'll add to our points tally.
This is the Bet McLean Football Show from Cool FM. Prediction time then, and the Danske Bank Premiership Friday night, Newry City against Glenavon, and Newry City have points on the board.
Yeah, it's been a good start for them. They had a good win last week, and their story's been tremendous, you know, coming, being relegated down and then coming up through the leagues again, and it's a club that I played against quite a lot in my career, and it's good to see them back. It was a ground I always enjoyed going to play at, but I think this week Glenavon will have too much for them. Their away form's pretty good. They're coming off the back of a good win last week, so I fancy Glenavon to win that one 2-0.
There's obviously a really good atmosphere and a really good team spirit in the Newry camp, but that can only get you so far.
Well, it's fantastic what Darren Mullen has achieved there, and he has got good players. They've got a good start in their home campaign. They're going to need that home form to continue, Pete, but on Friday night I can only see one winner. Having watched Glenavon against Warren Point, they are dynamic going forward. They've got it going on big style, and they're going to be a team to watch this season. They're so entertaining. I think they'll probably concede against Newry and will continue to concede this season because of the way they play. But with Big Andy and Sykes, the way they are at the moment and the form they're showing, I think Glenavon will win 3-1.
You went behind on Saturday against Warren Point. Do you reckon that was complacency?
I just think Warren Point started the game well. We didn't start well. And yeah, maybe it was a little bit of complacency at the back, but you know, everybody can make a mistake, and you know, we knew that we have the quality on our side to come back from a deficit. So it was good to get two quick goals after we went down under one down.
And how do you approach this for Friday night?
Yeah, we know Newry City is going to be a tough ask. We played them last year in the Middlesex Cup final, and they played very, very well, and We were fortunate to come away with the win in the final, but we know that they're a strong physical side, and you know, we just have to make sure that we go out and do what we do best and hopefully score a few goals.
What's it like as a striker playing under Gary Hamilton, because he was a brilliant striker himself?
Yeah, Gary was top class. I used to watch him whenever he played for Portadown and Glentoran, and to now him managing me is great, and he gives you that little bit of knowledge, and it's the same for Paul Miller as well. Paul's brilliant as well, and you know, having played here at Glentoran and at Linfield, he knows the league inside out, and his knowledge is invaluable too.
We moved to Saturday, Ards at home to Ballymena. Number of stories there. First and foremost, what was the atmosphere like with Colin when you came to shake his hand at the end of Saturday?
Listen, Colin is a winner. I played with him for 17 years. I know what he's like. He'll have taken that defeat pretty badly. But we shook hands. There's ultimate respect there between the two of us. We're good friends, and you know, we shook hands, and I seen him again after the game. And he was disappointed in how things went for his team. But he's got to move on now to the next game and try and pick his troops up again.
And following on from Ballymena taking points off Crusaders, he's up against it with no points on the board.
Yeah, it's all of a sudden that becomes a real pressure game for ours, and they've lost three players against us. They lost Sean Noble with a cruciate injury, which is really unfortunate for him, Kim Nelson and David Elibert. So the spine of their team as such is missing potentially for this game, so it makes it even tougher for ours. And Ballymena obviously have started the season well, and they've got good firepower, fresh players in the team, and a lot of pace in the team from all accounts against Crusaders last week. They caused Crusaders lots of problems. So I'm sorry to say to my mate Nicky, but I think Ballymena United will win that one and probably go for, again, 2-0.
2-0, big up.
The David Jeffrey factor's coming into play here, Pete.
It doesn't seem to, because he's changed so much of his team. I mean, he's got them playing even at this early stage.
Well, I think privately David Jeffrey would tell you maybe last season wasn't really his team. He's been building towards this. He's now got a team playing the way he wants them to play. He's got the individuals in there. And he's inspiring Johnny McMurray. That goal against Crusaders last week was absolutely brilliant. And I think he could be a key player for them this season. I know there was interest for him in other clubs. And I can see Ballymena winning this one. I'll go 2-1 to Jeffrey's team.
Andy?
Yeah, I think Ballymena have signed really well this year. They've got a sort of an influx of youth through the team. And I can probably see Ballymena win that one 3-1.
Okay. For me, the game of the weekend, Linfield still have no goals conceded. Will, you know, they still have a clean sheet come Saturday?
Unlikely, I would suggest. Crusaders against Linfield has turned into one of the games of the season, and it's brilliant that it's happening so early. It's going to be a packed house at Seaview. And I'm pretty certain that Stephen Baxter will have a few words to say to his team, because they don't want to be falling 5 points behind Linfield, even at this early stage. They'll be playing catch-up if that's the case. And Linfield, whenever they get their noses in front, can be a dangerous animal. David Healy's team have made a brilliant start to the season. I think there's a lot more to come from them, but I'm not sure they can get a victory at Crusaders. I think Crusaders will be so up for this one, it'll be untrue. Declan Cadell in particular, Colin Coates, Jordan Owens back in the team now. I think Stephen might revert to type and play all the big players that have won him trophies over the season. And I think Crusaders will win this one. Really interesting to see if Jamie Mulgrew comes back into the side, by the way, because he's available now. Mulgrew is probably, well, there's no doubt about it, actually. He's Linfield's best outfield player.
They missed him massively last season.
Big style. So that's a big call for David Healy. But I still fancy, even if Jamie plays, that Crusaders will have the bit between their teeth and will show what champions are made of and will win 2-1 on Saturday.
Paul?
It's a tough one, the call, Pete. I think Crusaders' loss of Colin Coates last week against Ballymena was a key factor for them. He steadies their back line. They conceded a couple of goals there last week, so Stephen will be hoping Colin's back available again, and I think that's that will be a big boost for Crusaders. As Steven Beacom has said there, I see there being a few goals in this game. You know, both teams like the attack. Linfield have obviously kept two clean sheets, so something has to give. If you're asking me, I think it could be a 2-2 draw, this one. I think it'll be a cracking game. I got to see a lot of football the last couple of seasons, and those games were always great affairs.
You played under Stephen Baxter. What you know, what makes him the manager that he is?
He's a great man manager. Everyone obviously respects him first and foremost because he was a great footballer. But as a manager, he's a fantastic manager, a man manager, someone who knows how to get the best out of his players. And on a Saturday, he just comes into his own in the dressing room in terms of motivation and how he gets his teams prepared and how he gets them up for these big games. And you know, it's been proven over the last few years how well Crusaders have done. They've got a great manager in Stephen at the helm, and you know, all those players have been loyal to him, the coaches, the Cadells, the Owens.
Yeah.
He knows how to get the best out of them.
He always puts on a brave face in post-match, but you know, Ballymena taking points off them last week. Behind the scenes, how good would he have been?
Yeah, he'll be disappointed because, as Stephen said earlier, there's a little bit of a gap there now between themselves and Coleraine, and he doesn't want that to happen early on, so he'll be disappointed, but you know, it'll give him the motivation this Saturday that they have to beat Linfield, and he'll have those boys well prepared for it.
A draw, the ideal result for you boys?
Probably. I was going to say exactly 2-2 draw. Both sides have got a lot of quality in their ranks, and I think there will be goals. And I'm going with a 2-2 draw. Probably a last minute equaliser for one of the teams.
Whenever you know you go to face the likes of Crusaders, how much impetus is there just to raise your game that little bit more whenever you know?
You should always raise your game for every game, but especially when you're playing the top teams. You want to go there and you want to show what you're about. And you know, I think we went down to Crusaders last year and we got a couple of decent results. I think we drew and we won. And you know, whenever you're playing the big teams, it's always important to take points off them. So yeah, you really do need to raise your game.
Dungannon Swifts at home to Cliftonville. Rodney McAree must be reeling from the last 2 weeks.
Rodney will have been thinking at the start of the season that in his first two games, we'll have 6 points. Right now, he's got zero. So there will be pressure attached to this match. And knowing Barry Gray like I do, he will be fuming that his team lost late on to Coleraine, Pete, on Saturday. And I expect a reaction. And I think Dungannon might be sitting with 0 points after three games. I look at Cliftonville and I look at the creativity in that side. I look at the potent strike force. And I do believe they will be title challengers. but they can't lose concentration like they did in the latter minutes of that match against Coleraine. And that's why I think they'll bounce back. I think Cliftonville will go to Stanmore Park and will come back down the road with a 2-1 win.
2-1.
I fancy Cliftonville. I mean, obviously, you've got a chance to see them first game of the season. Certainly, the loss of Harney and Breen has been big for them, but they've brought in Richard Bruce, who's a fantastic goalkeeper. He's only going to strengthen them. And if they get those two defenders back, I do see them causing teams lots of problems. They work very good against us in terms of how they pass the ball. They keep the ball really well, and they've got a great strike force, and the Donnelly brothers and Joe Gormley. So I just think they'll have too much for Dungannon. Rodney will be looking for a response from his team, but I just think Cliftonville will have too much for him, and I think that could be a 2-1 win for them.
You mentioned Joe Gormley. How many goals do you reckon he'll get this season?
Joe Gormley's just a goal machine. He's an out-and-out striker that, you know, he's going to guarantee you 20 goals. I mean, people were saying last season he had a poor season by his own standards, and I think he still got 30 goals. So, you know, he's just phenomenal, and he scores goals from everywhere.
And as a defender, you know, you see Joe Gormley in the team sheet. What way do you mark against him?
Yeah, I mean, he's one of those players, like against us, he didn't do an awful lot in the game, but he still got his goal. The chance came and he took it, and that's Joe Gormley. If you switch off as a defender, if you switch off for 1 second against him, the ball's in the back of the net. That's how good he is. You know, people like Glenn Ferguson, Vinnie Arkins, Gary Hamilton, they were all like that. They were all as good as that, and Joe's certainly up there in that pedigree.
Who was number one that you faced?
Spike.
By a distance?
Glenn Ferguson, yeah, I have to say, all round, he just had everything, you know. Defensively, he went back, he marked different corners. He was as a striker in the box, he just had everything in his game. He could hold the ball up, bring people into play, he could score headed goals, volleys, score from everywhere, and just the ultimate professional as well. He's top man in my eyes.
Your prediction?
Obviously, I haven't played for Dungannon before. I think they'll score, but I think it'll probably be Cliftonville's day. Cliftonville are very, very good going forward, and as you said, Joe Gormley, he knows where the net is, he's top quality. And with Jay Donnelly there as well, and they've a really strong midfield, I think they'll win 3-1.
Two more games to get through. You boys are at home to Coleraine.
Yeah, I'm not going to give you any predictions on this one. All I know is it's going to be a tough game for us on Saturday, because Coleraine are such a good side, and I think they've only lost one away game in over a year.
At Windsor?
Yeah, it's, you know, their record is just phenomenal, and the job that Oren's done there is fantastic, and they'll be looking to go further than last season again, so they've got that motivation. So it's going to be a tough day at the office for us, but we've just got to go in and get the same, you know, prepare the team well. If we get the same effort from the boys as we've been getting, you know, we'll give them a good game, and hopefully we're well in it, and who knows what can happen in football. I mean, I was at the game last season when John McGuigan missed a penalty in the last kick of the game to beat Coleraine for Glentoran. So, you know, anything can happen, and hopefully we get a little bit of luck on our side this week.
And you will look at the result Ballymena got at Seaview as inspiration?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, we've got good players in the team. Our starting 11, there's still some quality in there, and the boys, there's a real good spirit in the camp at this moment in time. The guys are working hard, and we can't ask for any more than that. And if we get that effort from them that we've had in the previous games, we'll be okay.
All right, big up.
When you've Curtis Allen and John McGuigan up front, you should have a chance.
And both scored last week.
Yeah, so they'll go into the match in confident form. But I just think Coleraine are too good. Sorry, Paul, but I just think they're a much superior side to Glentoran, and I think that will show. Glentoran have to start really fast against Coleraine and get on top of them and get in their faces and make it difficult for them. Otherwise, Coleraine will just outclass them.
Aaron Burns, will he start?
He should start, in my opinion. He scored 2 goals coming off the bench. He recently had a new baby, so congratulations to him and his partner on that. And you know what? Whenever you have a baby, you feel as if you're Superman. You feel as if you can take on the world. So it was no surprise to me.
I can only picture you thinking of yourself in that baby.
Well, do you know what? Whenever Aaron came on, I knew he was going to score, because he's confident, he's class, he's got it all, really, in terms of being a footballer. And I think it's going to be very hard for Oren Kearney to leave him out. But it's a great decision for Oren Kearney to have to make. And I think Coleraine will go to the Oval really confident after that win against Cliftonville. And unless Glentoran are really at it, and I mean 1-11 at it right from the start, Coleraine could win that one pretty comfortably. I'm going to go 3-1 to Coleraine. And again, sorry, Leeper, but you know me. I call it how I see it.
You called ours last week as well.
Andrew? Coleraine have really started off where they left off last year. I think it's going to be a closer game than maybe what you think. I'm actually going to go for a draw. Both teams have good quality going forward, as you say, Aaron Burns and Owen Bradley, McGonagall for Coleraine, and when you've got Curtis Allen on the team, anything can happen. So I'm going to go for a 1-1 draw.
Interesting.
Andrew Mitchell's been sitting on the fence all
yeah.
day.
All day.
Final game of the weekend, and I'm really excited for Institute against Warren Point. Warren Point are struggling, no points on the board. Institute got a great win in the first game at the Brandywell. So.
Well, I know Steve McDonald's really looking forward to going to the Brandywell. I think every manager will, every player will. It's a brilliant ground to play football at. But Warren Point need to get something out of that match, because they could be 6 points behind Institute after three games if they lose. And bear in mind, Institute and Warren Point are two out of the three teams that are going to be battling relegation, Newry being the other. So I fancy this one will actually be a draw. I'm going to do what Andy's doing here and sitting the fence. I'm going to go a 2-2. I think Warren Point have goals in them, no question about that. Leaky as a sieve at the back. Desperate on occasions, I've got to say, basic fundamental errors which they have got to eradicate from their game. But they certainly have enough to get a point at Institute, who will be thinking they can win the game, but they won't. It'll be 2-2.
Andy?
I'm actually going to go for Institute this time. I think Institute will win. I think the Brandywell will be a tough place to go this year. And I think travelling from Warren Point all the way up be a difficult. It'll be a difficult game for Warren Point. I know they need to win, but I just see Institute sneaking at 2-1.
Paul?
I think Institute going to go 1-0 for Institute. I think both teams like to try and play football the right way, so it could be a pretty open game, but I just think Institute will just make it 1-0. And just with being the home team as such and having played there a bit more, I'll go for them. That's the only reason. It's a tough one to call.
Gentlemen, good luck for the weekend. Thank you very much for joining us. Hopefully we'll see you again later in the season. Beacom, always a pleasure. And that's it for this week's Bet McLean Football Show from Cool FM. Of course, keep your eyes peeled for more as the weeks continue and the drama mounts in the Danske Bank Premiership.